Okay, so I will move to a much more mechanical approach of bone remodeling. So here the goal is to try to identify constitutive laws for trabecular bone samples, relying on real images, and trying to inform the macroscopic model with microstructural information gained at the scale of individual trabecular. So this is based on an ongoing PhD thesis. So the work is far from being finished. So you know, all know this view that also Francesco presented 5 minutes ago. I will not consider the nanoscale, so I will address the link between the microscale, so the scale of the trabecular network, and the macroscale, so the scale of a whole bone specimen like this one. And the motivation is to account for the evolution of microstructure, so typically the surface remodeling phenomena that are due to the apposition of the mineral, so hydroxyapatite, on the external layer of such a trabecula. And this information about the remodeling velocity and the shape change should be incorporated into constitutive laws built at the macro scale. So this is the main motivation of this presentation. And I will consider that at the scale of individual trabecula, so at the scale of such a microstructure, the very mechanism by which a bone grows is surface growth. So we will neglect possible evolutions of the internal density at this scale, and we'll focus only on surface growth. And then I will try to move to the next scale, which is the macroscopic scale, to formulate volumetric growth models, also in conjunction with the constitutive laws that are needed both on this surface and at the macro scale. So surface growth from a biological viewpoint describes accretion and deposition of some material, so hydroxyapatite for bone, in hard tissues. So it is known as a classification that soft tissues are more prone to volumetric growth, whereas hard tissues mostly grow by a surface mechanism. And there is a second classification. So either there is a fixed growing surface of the so-called generating cells, so it is the cells that will produce a new material. So this is a situation typically for nails or horns. Or we are in a more general situation of moving growing surfaces, as for seashells or antlers. So here you see, I think, one of the first work in the literature. There is also one paper by Scalac. It's kind of funny paper because it shows surfaces of horns, antlers, that are produced just by using a kinematic model. So it's like in fluid mechanics, the prescription of the velocity field, and then integrating this velocity field in time is able to produce these images. But in fact, there is no mechanics, so it does not contain the mechanical reason why these shapes will be obtained during growth. These are computation results due to the group of Alain Gorielli in UK. So it looks very realistic, in fact, and very close to physiology. But these are only simulations. But we want to put more mechanics into the model. So I will present our kinematic picture of the surface growth model we have implemented at the scale of individual trabecula. So here you see, in fact, the more biological view in which this seal zone in which the specialized cells will remove bones, so the red cells osteoclast, and then followed by the other cells, the osteoblast, will oppose new bone. So this seal zone has a very small thickness, about 60 microns in trabecular and cortical bone. So in fact, mass growth at this scale only occurs through surfaces, and this will generate shape change. Now, due to the fact that the new accumulated material, so the mineral will have a density which may be different from that of the bulk, which made the parent material, this will introduce internal strains, residual stresses, and this also will lead to the phenomenon of volumetric growth, which is the apparent phenomena that we notice at the macro scale, but which will be due to surface mechanism. So this kinematic viewpoint is physically consistent with the physiology, and it is accordingly realistic to model a pure surface growth mechanism at the micro level of individual trabecula. So the surface growth kinematics, in fact, it follows a picture which was given in this paper written by Rodriguez and co-workers in 94, which parallels the Lee decomposition in elastoplasticity. So the total transformation gradient, capital F, is a product of a growth mapping, so this FG, which is responsible for the growth process and mass change. And since this configuration is not, in general, not compatible from kinematic point of view, there is a need to introduce an additional elastic mapping to restore overall kinematic compatibility. So this is known for volumetric growth, and we here extend this for surface growth. So what is a surface mapping? So the surface deformation gradient, F tilde, can be defined as the tangent projection of the volumetric mapping capital F onto the tangent surface. So by this projection operator, and this F tilde can be further decomposed into a surface growth part described by this F tilde G times an elastic surface part. Okay. Of course, it holds as a consequence the decomposition of the Jacobian here, so which describes the change of area due to surface growth. One assumption we are doing is that the mass growth only occurs between the initial configuration and the intermediate configuration, but there is mass conservation between the intermediate and actual configuration. So we have this relation between the surface density, so this is kinematics between omega A and omega T, but for surface densities. So surface. It's normally different. It will be the surface density of the mineral phase, hydroxyapatite. So the question of measurement of this density, this is another question. So we start from the setting up of a surface-free energy density, so it's energy per unit area, so this psi s, it could depend on, of course, F tilde, but also on the normal, based on the belief that there could be curvature effects on growth, and possibly on the material point, because simply growth is heterogeneous by nature. So this is a previous kinematic decomposition, which is recalled. Then we get the balance of momentum in different ways. And we could start from a potential energy, stationarity condition of a potential energy, or we could pull back the Eulerian equation of equilibrium. So this is written on the reference configuration, not on the actual configuration. It's a complicated story to explain why it is more natural or logical to express this in the reference configuration, because this is actually the game of people in configurational mechanics. From physiological point of view, we can assume that evolution of microstructure in living tissues is different from the motion. So we have to solve equilibrium equation. This is a motion problem, but in biology, there is an evolution of microstructure which occurs in the reference configuration. So this is one motivation to introduce this surface Eschelby stress. So it is built on this psi s. So it is F. So F is a elastic surface mapping. T tilde is a nominal surface stress built from the partial derivative of psi s. Here, so this is a second order tensor, the trace of which is the energy density. Typically, and in this equation, equilibrium equation, so we have the surface divergence here of this HLB stress. We have some surface force field which could be introduced as a boundary condition, as a static boundary condition, and we have the curvature. So this is a gradient of the normal. It is the curvature tensor, sometimes called Weingarten map in the more mathematical literature. So this is the equation we have to solve at each point of the growing surface. Bone usually develops only small strains. This is well known. So we can linearize the kinematics reasonably. So instead of a multiplicative decomposition, we can write an additive decomposition of the total surface strain into elastic and growth parts. The effective properties may be obtained by some homogenization scheme. So if we have a model, a geometrical model of the microstructure, this was done by Gibson and Ashby and other people like me also, we can compute the effective properties by homogenization of the microstructure, and then we get also scaling laws of the effective properties versus effective density. So the surface strain energy density here introduces a cubic dependency on the surface density here via these two elastic moduli. Poisson ratio, usually you find it in the literature around 0.3, so we keep this this value. We also introduce a dependency of the homogenized modulus versus tissue density, so this is taken from the literature. And it reflects that the mineral phase is not the only constituent of bone tissue. There is also water, proteoglycan, etc. And so we use this quadratic expression. And we use also a minimum stress here, this CMAG, to promote remodeling. So I will explain how this is computed. It represents some kind of homeostatic stress which is integrated into the model. So in order to write a model or an expression of the remodeling velocity here, so this is a velocity on the surface which is growing by apposition of mineral, we exploit Clausius-Duhem inequality after a few transformations. We identify the surface dissipation and then we get this expression here. So this is a simple model relating linearly the surface growth velocity to the driving force which is identified to the surface divergence of HLB stress. So this will be our driving force for surface remodeling, and this surface process will generate internal stresses within the bulk of the material. So here we rely on 3D microcity scan data of cubic samples. So the typical size is about 10 millimeter per linear dimension per side. The typical voxel size is about 9 microns. And then we do, so this is classical now. If you have a dedicated software, you can do data segmentation and then produce a mesh of these microstructures. And in fact, in this talk, I will only present 2D computations. So we extracted from this original 3D view a 2D section. And in fact, we produced different sizes, so microstructure which are more and more refined, so which include more and more of such cavities, so to study the possible size effects. So we have to define, because we are doing now homogenization, so we want to integrate this surface remodeling model into a volumetric growth model at the macro scale. So this is the main objective. So we have to define first the average kinematics. So this is average rate of growth tensor, which is defined similarly to this guy. So by the divergence, classical divergence theorem, you can rewrite the average of the gradient of the velocity in terms of the surface integral of the dyadic product of the velocity field with the normal to the surface. So by analogy, we define here the surface growth velocity gradient, which is built from the surface velocity, and then by taking the symmetrical part, here we get the average rate of growth tensor that will be computed in the simulation. So here you have simulations, so which are a little bit independent from those developments, just to show that we could also use a single trabecular as a representative unit cell with periodicity boundary conditions, and analyze the effect of applied stress or strain on the development of surface growth mechanism. So here what we see is that surface growth mostly occurs where the strain is maximum. So this tends to show that the strain is, or the maximum strain is a stimulus that bone feels in order to produce some new bone on the surface. So continuing, we can define the volumetric growth rate. So what is it? It is the amount of the volume that has been increased for the newly produced bone at the macroscopic level divided by the actual volume of bone. And this can be, in fact, rewritten as a surface integral by very simple mathematics. So if we know the surface growth velocity field on the surface of the trabecular, we are able to compute the volumetric growth rate. It's very easy to define the average rate of the total deformation tensor as this symmetrical tensor, and then what is missing in this kinematic picture is the average elastic rate of deformation tensor, this DE bar, which is just the difference between the total rate of deformation tensor and its growth part. So knowing this, we can then trace back to the elastic properties, so effective elastic properties of the representative unit cell, as I will explain later on. So of course we can split now the total volume into the bone part with this fraction FB, and then we have the complementary marrow phase which occupies the fraction FM, and then based on this is simply a mixture rule to express all kinematic quantities versus those of the bone phase or the marrow phase. So this is relatively easy to do. So this is a typical microstructure we are using. So we can define, this is classical in the theory of first order homogenization, we can define the average strain over this RUC as this volume integral of the gradient of the displacement, and this is also the gradient of the macroscopic displacement. This is proven classically in homogenization theory. We write here the kinematic decomposition of the strain, average strain rate into the growth and elastic strain rates. Here some parenthesis is missing. This is what we search for, so a relation between the average growth rates over this RUC versus applied stress, so the external stress, and effective density. So here, this does not depend on the rate of density, so this can be proven, because in fact in the model no volumetric growth occurs when the effective density is constant. So how do we get the effective stress? So we apply a kinematic load, because as you know, if you want to identify effective moduli in homogenization theory, you have to apply a sequence of elementary kinematic loading. But you can easily then get from the effective properties, so from this tensor of effective rigidities, you can trace back the effective stress, which will be the average stress over this RUC. So we have to solve a set of elastic problems with different kinematic controls and then evaluate the effective moduli and finally get the effective stress, which will be the mechanical driving force for volumetric growth at the macro scale. So how do we compute moduli? So I just recall the classical method. We apply the principle of strain energy equivalence based on Hill-Mandel lemma. So we identify the strain energy density of the effective postulated continuum, which is here a Cauchy continuum. So there is no issue with a higher order gradient moduli. And then we identify this with energy computed by faint elements over the real microstructure. And so, for instance, if we want to identify this modulus C12, we have to apply to simulate a Birkshell extension test. So we apply this kinematic loading on the face with normal N1, and this kinematic loading, so linear displacement versus the coordinate, on the N2 face, and then we. It's not calling at the right time. And then we identify this C12 shear modulus, provided we know already C11 and C22. So this is the value we get for this all those moduli. And case 1, 2, 3 means simply that we are increasing the size. So we analyze size effects, and we see that those moduli are pretty stable when we increase the size. So we are not obliged to use a huge model to make the computation of effective properties. So we can content ourselves with this RUC instead of this one. So this was the first result. I will not bother you too much with the algorithmic aspect, but just realize that this is not so easy, because we have to solve a surface growth problem, which means that we have to compute the surface velocity, which is written here, versus the surface HLB stress. And of course, the surface information comes from the bulk, so there is a continuity. It's not only by the trace theorem in mathematics. We have to ensure the continuity of the fields from the bulk to the surface. So this surface information is next an input to compute the volumetric behavior. So bone is basically the bulk of bone is a linear elastic material with density dependent moduli. Here, so we use cubic function of density, but we could use also properties based on homogenization methods, and this is the kinematics for the effective constitutive growth. And from this, we try to identify now a proper evolution law for the volumetric growth model. So here we show the simulations which have been done from this initial configuration under different loadings. So this is a uniaxial along X, uniaxial along Y. This is a simple shear test. We notice that we have high strains at the conjunction of trabecular struts. And this confirms the scenario that maximum strain will lead to also maximum bone formation. So what we had previously at the scale of individual trabecula also appears here at this scale of more complex microstructures. Of course, we have to follow the evolution of the moduli versus the remodeling time step. So here we plot the different moduli versus time, so versus the remodeling process. And we see that effective tensile moduli, so here C11, will in fact increase much faster compared to the shear components here. And this is in fact due to local shear stress, which are induced by applied shear strain, will not produce so much volumetric growth, but they will mostly change the shape, but not the volume. And this is, of course, not the case for tensile strain. So if we apply tensions, then we will induce much more surface remodeling, and this will in turn induce volumetric change. So this is a mechanism to explain also this dependency of the moduli on the state of growth. So I now come to the last part of the talk. So in order to identify the constitutive model, we rely on the additive decomposition of the strain energy, so I don't know why parentheses are missing, into an elastic part depending on the effective elastic strain and a growth part depending on the effective growth strain. And also here we have the accumulated growth strain, which is built from this guy, from this integral here over time. We set up a dissipation potential, so this is a classical framework of irreversible thermodynamics. So this dissipation potential is written in stress space, so it's von Mises type, so it's dependent on the effective stress, equivalent stress. This equivalent stress here is built from the two invariants, so the trace, which describe hydrostatic effects, and also the second stress invariance, which is associated to shear. So it is built from the shear part of Cauchy stress. And since we do not know a priori, we include a driving force XG, which describes kinematic growth hardening, and another one which will be descriptive of isotropic growth hardening. So here, this is what we get finally. So we show, because of the remodeling law, that there is no time hardening in this model, so it's like primary creep for metals. So bone growth is here only promoted by stress, and also know that there is no physical time in our model because we have no viscosity. There is no marrow phase that would introduce a viscosity. So our growth evolution law is the following. So we have one part which is hydrostatic, which is promoted by the first invariant, and the second one which is deviatoric, which is associated to the second invariant with two coefficients, alpha and beta, that we have to identify. So based on the fact that we have very little size effects on growth, we can rely on a not so fine RUC for our computations. So the first thing is to discard kinematic growth. So we made computation in which we change the sign of the applied stress, so tension or compression, and then we show that the growth process is not sensitive to the sign of the applied stress, which means that we can neglect kinematic growth. So in turn we get this expression of the average growth rate versus the stress here, and with this sigma g, which is computed as 10 megapascal based on some reference from the literature. So this work from 2007, stating that the strain level necessary for bone formation is of the order of 2 to the power 10 minus 3. So this leads to this value of 10 megapascal for the homeostatic stress, adopting a tensile modulus of bone, maximum modulus of 15 gigapascal. So this is the response we get for the different components. So we separate the hydrostatic part, so the trace of DG, from the shear part or the deviatoric part versus the associated component of the stress. We see that there is a significant effect of the hydrostatic pressure, but this was expected. So the volume will double over the range of applied hydrostatic stress here. And we see also that the second invariant, in fact, is more influential on growth, because we need a lower, much lower value of the deviatory component of stress in comparison to the hydrostatic part of the stress. So how do we identify our coefficients here, alpha, beta, k, and capital N? It is just by a least square fitting. So we perform computations based on the different kinematic modes we can apply to the unit cell, so in tension, in shear, and we also change the stress level, so we get these coefficients. And we show next the capability of the model to predict the response of these bone specimens in for loadings which were not used for the calibration. Otherwise, it would be a nonsense game. So here we show the capability of the model to extrapolate beyond the kinematic loadings that were used for the identification of the coefficients. So we have finally a constitutive law that can be used at the macro scale to perform computation of bone growth for real specimens. So I would like to close this talk with a more theoretical aspect, because here the belief is that volumetric growth, in fact, is the result of surface growth mechanism. So this is also what we could believe in physics. If we produce mass and volume change, it is because there are some entities at a more microscopic level which oppose growth, but at the scale of a surface, not at the volume. So here, what is the objective? It is to formally rewrite the mechanics of growing bodies based on homogenization of surface mechanism. So if you remember this literature, of course you have non-conserved all quantities are no more conserved because there is a source. So let's take any quantity capital A described by a specific density. So small a is the density of capital A 2 minutes. So per unit mass. So here this is a balance law. We have a source term here and a flux here responsible for the time variation of capital A. On the other hand, by Reynolds transport theorem, I can compute the material derivative of capital A, and here highlights the surface part, which is due to the surface apposition mechanism described by the surface growth velocity. And introduce here the growth velocity. So the growth velocity, what is it? It is the velocity of material points with respect to the velocity of the interface or surface that contains the generating cells. So here, for instance, for the mass balance equation, we can identify so this term here, in which we can no more distinguish between the mass production and the fluxes, because they are all gathered into this scalar as due to this surface growth mechanism. So we can do this for momentum and energy, like here. I will not go into the details, but finally it gives some more physical explanation why we have volumetric growth, especially for bone. So just a few words to conclude. So it's quite interesting, actually, of course, to have a database of images from a specific patients, and of course it remains a lot of work to be done, especially we are doing this morning lectures to do a more statistical analysis to try to classify these growth models to integrate the state of the patient. One aspect we are investigating now is, in fact, to incorporate the second gradient effects into the growth model, because we have strong strain gradients within the RUC. So actually, it's quite challenging to identify second gradient model in this specific case of bone remodeling, and of course, also plan to introduce viscoelastic effects due to the marrow phase. So thanks for your attention and patience.
Thank you very much. We have time for one question. Basically, could you please come back to the slide with the splitting of the energy density? You have a group. The physical meaning of the first term, not the energy of
this one?
The energy and then a growth energy.
Later. Yeah. This one.
Could you please expand on the physical meaning of the second term? Since the first term is clear. You have the elastic energy, which is
Right. It could be the energy due to residual stresses, for instance, due to growth.
Yeah, but that shouldn't this energy be already included in the first term?
It could. I agree. It's a little bit artificial to have this split. We can move. We can decide to move. In fact, this part to the first one. Yes. In fact, we use basically mostly the first part, elastic part, to build the constitutive law. Yeah. So the second one is used more formally to derive the dissipation and then to identify the evolution of internal variables, so the growth model.
Okay, one more question, one short question.
There is one question. This is a maximum modulus.
This is at the tissue scale? Is that what we can recover after the homogenization?
No, it is at tissue scale. After homogenization, we get much lower value.
My question is, if you multiply by 2 this modulus, will you multiply by 2 the remodeling? Is there some kind of simple relationship between the
I cannot give you a precise answer because we did not do the computation. Of course, it will. If you increase modulus, you will increase stresses. But I guess it's not linear, so we have to check. Yeah. To have have some kind of maps.
Yeah. Thank you very much for that.